حبيب الله رسول الله حبيب الله Allah our God is the greatest the one and only glory to him he wanted humans to be the best and give his best religion to them Allah our God is the greatest the one and only glory to him He wanted humans to be the best and give his best religion to
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillah wa salatu wa salamu ala nabiyihi wa mustafa Sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man walah wa ba'd. Brothers and sisters, welcome to an episode number 147 in the series of Gardens of the Pious. Inshallah, today we'll continue explaining chapter number 33, and that is going to be the third episode in this chapter. May Allah make it easy for us to learn the useful knowledge and then act upon it and accept it all from us. Allahumma ameen. The hadith that we will begin with today is a very interesting hadith that I believe most Muslims are aware of it. It is concerning sponsoring the orphans, looking after orphans, supporting orphans, and the virtues of doing so. Everybody knows the hadith that the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the person who would do kafalatul yateem will be with me in paradise like these two fingers. And he pointed with the index and the middle finger, indicating that it is such a great honor for a person to look after an orphan, to sponsor an orphan. Let's look into the hadith. And then the following hadith, I would like to quote it as well before we start the sharh, because they are relating to each other. So hadith number 262 is narrated by Sahl ibn Sa'd al-Sa'idi radiyallahu anhu. Qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ana wa kafilu al-yateem fi al-jannah hakadha wa ashara bis-sababati wal-wusta wa farraja baynahuma. In this hadith, which is collected by Imam al-Bukhari, the great companion Sahl ibn Sa'd al-Sa'idi, may Allah be pleased with him, narrated that the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, said, I will be like this in paradise with the person who takes care of an orphan. He, peace be upon him, raised his forefinger and the middle finger by way of illustration. So when he said that, I will be like this, he meant so close. The person who would take care of an orphan will be so close to me like these two fingers close to each other, the middle and the index finger. Again, the following hadith, as I said, I would like to study the two hadith together because the meaning is close. But the second hadith, which is hadith number 263, has an extra information that we will elaborate on it, inshallah. The hadith is narrated by Abu Huraira, radiyallahu anhu, qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, kafilu al-yateemi, lahu aw li ghayrihi, ana wa huwa kahataini fil jannah, wa ashara al-rawi, wa huwa Malik ibn Anas, bis-sababati wal-wusta. Rawahu Muslim. Abu Huraira, may Allah be pleased with him, narrated that the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, said, he who takes care of an orphan, whether he is a relative to the orphan or he is not, like he is a stranger, will be in paradise with me like these two fingers. And the narrator, Anas ibn Malik, pointed with the forefinger, the index finger, and the middle one, by means of illustration. Okay. So, what is the general meaning of the hadith? Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in both the hadith is encouraging the ummah to take care of each other. The strong to take care of the weak, the rich to take care of the poor, those who have to give, those who do not have. And he pointed out, by means of emphasizing that, especially orphans, whenever they lose their father. What is the definition of an orphan? Al-yateem is an orphan. And in the Arabic language, al-yatim is the child who loses his or her father while they are under the age of puberty. So they are called yatim. And yatima for feminine. Aitam is the plural. فَأَمَّا الْيَتِيمَ فَلَا تَقَهَرْ in Surah Al-Duha. Do not oppress nor repel the orphan. Al-Yatim is the one who loses his father or both parents. But the person who loses his mother is not a yatim, because his father is still living and he looks after him. The person who provides for the family is dead, and the family is going through turmoil. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings to the attention of the whole ummah, you guys, if you want to enter paradise, if you want to be so close to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, pay attention to those who are in need, because they lost their father, their main provider. They lost their guardian. So treat them as you treat your own children. That's why he said, kafil. Al-kafala is to take care of the orphan and all their needs, whether financial or moral, education, tarbiyah, medication, you know, you name it. It's not that you just pay for their school tuition. This is just one band. Their food supply. And one of them got sick, or their mother got sick. They need an operation. They needed a surgery. You rush them to the hospital. You sense that they are going through some hard time. You stand next to them. That's called kafala. In English, they use the word adoption or the term adoption. And some people, when they're asked about adoption in Islam, adopting an orphan, some people say it's haram. This is not exactly true. There is a difference between adoption in a sense of al-kafala, to look after an orphan, to sponsor them, to take care of their needs, to provide for them, to educate them, to be for them like a dad or a father. And the other one, which is a prohibited form, is when people go to an orphanage, for instance, and they pick up a child whose father is unknown. The biological father is unknown. So they raise them, and they consider them like their original children. So he would give that child, whether he or she, their own last name. But this person's father is there somewhere, whether he is known or not. And this child is not from your line. The Quran ordered us to look after the orphans, to be kind to the orphans, to sponsor orphans. But he forbade us in Surah Al-Ahzab to give them your last name. Because it implies the following. When you give a child your last name and he is not actually your son, he is not from your line, or a girl who is an orphan, you give her your last name and you treat her like your branch, you are an origin for her, and she is like you are your own daughter, then you will treat her as a woman who is forbidden for you to take her in marriage as a wife. And is that true? No, that's not true, because this girl, even though there is, of course, a big gap, whether due to the age or because you are the one who raised her, but still, she's not your daughter. You're not allowed to give her your last name. That's why we find the ayah in Surah Al-Ahzab. Allah the Almighty says in this ayah, أُدْعُوهُمْ لِآبَائِهِمْ هُوَ أَقْسَطُ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ. Even if you don't know their fathers, still, you do not give them your last name, because he is not your son. She is not your daughter. فَإِنْ لَمْ تَعْلَمُوا آبَاءَهُمْ فَإِخْوَانُكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ وَمَوَالِيكُمْ. And of course, this ayah has a reason behind its revelation. And it took a long story in order to eliminate this common practice where the person would treat an adopted child as his own child. In a sense, that the person would consider the adopted daughter like my own daughter. So in this case, she doesn't have to wear hijab before me. And obviously, when my own daughter comes home, she gives me a hug and a kiss, and my daughter. And if it is a boy, he does the same with the mother, you know, parents and children. But those kids whom Allah the Almighty ordered us to look after, to sponsor and, you know, to adopt, ordered us to be careful not to treat them as your own line, as your own children, because they are not actually. So I hope that we understand the difference in this regard. On one hand, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to adopt the children, to do the aytam, the orphans, and to do kafala, and He promised a magnificent reward for those who look after orphans. But on the other hand, He stated that you should not give them your last name. If this is the case, then is it permissible for a wife, whenever she gets married, to change her family name to be named after her husband's name? Obviously not. That is not permissible. And this is a very common practice in the West, and many Muslim families, they adopt the same practice unknowingly. And they think it is okay. No, it is not okay. It is haram. And it is a very big haram. It's a major sin. You keep your own name. ادعوهم لآبائهم هو أقسط عند الله. Ascribe them to their own fathers. That is more just with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and before Him. So with all the ahadith talking about the status of the one who sponsors and takes care or adopts an orphan, and Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam emphasized that great honor by saying, such person will be with me in paradise like these two. And he pointed with بِأَصْبَعَيْهِ الْوُسْطَى وَالسَّبَّابَ. Al-wusta is the middle finger, and as-sabbaba is the forefinger or the index finger. Sometimes it is used and it is called sabbaba, and sometimes it is called sabbaha or al-musabbiha. Why? Sabbaba from sabab, which is insulting and cursing. You know, when somebody is telling somebody off and talking harsh to them, they point with the index finger like that. So they insult, they curse, and they tell off, and they warn with the index finger. That's why ever since the Arab use this as a sign of warning and being very angry, so they call it as-sababa, because it is commonly used in as-sabab, insulting and telling off. And in our salah, whenever we sit for tashahud, we point with the forefinger to say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. And the khatib on the Jumu'ah prayer, while giving the khutbah, he points while making dua with the forefinger. That's why it's also called as-sabbaha, musabbiha, because it makes tasbih. It glorifies Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And sometimes without saying a word, when you point with the index finger like that, it indicates that you are monotheistic. That's why you point with the index finger in tashahud and say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. I bear witness that there is no God to be worshipped but Allah. So now we know the two names of as-sabbaba and as-sabbaha and the reasons behind the two names. Al-wusta, the indication when once the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself pointed with the two fingers, and then when Anas ibn Malik illustrated what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam meant in the hadith which is narrated by Abu Hurairah, it means that subhanallah, there will be no barrier between you and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in paradise. And that was the ultimate goal of the companions, and it is the ultimate goal of all the true followers of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Do you guys remember Rabi'ah ibn Ka'b al-Aslami? When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wanted to reward him, he said, Salni ya Rabi'ah, ask of me. He said, Ya Rasulullah, as'aluka murafaqataka fil jannah. All what I'm asking is to be with you in paradise. Obviously, when all the believers enter paradise, they will be all in heaven, but not in the same grade, not in the same category, not in the same level. There will be higher people. There is Aliyin and there is Al-Firdaus Al-A'la, which is the highest level of paradise. May Allah make us all amongst the dwellers of Al-Firdaus Al-A'la. And this is what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam encouraged us whenever we make dua to aim high, to say, Allahumma inna nas'aluka al-Firdaus Al-A'la min al-Jannah, which is the highest room in paradise. So Rabi'a ibn Ka'b al-Aslami said, I want to be with you. Not just I want to enter Al-Jannah. Similar to the Pharaoh's wife when she said, Rabbi ibni li indaka baytan fil Jannah. Build a house for me with you in paradise. I don't just want to enter paradise. I want to have an access to see you. The Sahaba wanted to have an access to see the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam day and night. What did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say to Rabi'a? Said, أَعِنِّي عَلَى نَفْسِكَ بِكَثْرَةِ السُّجُودِ. Help me out to achieve this high status. Offer as much nawafil as possible, as much sujood as possible. When Thawban, may Allah be pleased with him, was sad, and the Prophet ﷺ asked him, what is saddening you? He said, Ya Rasulullah, every time I desire to see you, I just come to the masjid. And once I lay my eyes upon you, I feel comfortable. By Allah, O Prophet of Allah, you are dearer to me than my own wife, my children, my parents, and wallahi, more than my own self. وَكُلَّمَا ذَكَرْتُ مَوْتِي وَمَوْتَكَ. And every time I remember that you will die, and I will die too, I just feel sad. Because I don't know what is going to happen in heaven, and whether I will be able to see you as often. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the ayah of Surah النساء ومن يطع الله والرسول فأولئك مع الذين أنعم الله عليهم من النبيين والصديقين والشهداء والصالحين وحسن أولئك رفيقا. I believe 69 chapter number 4. Okay, there is now an act which will fulfill that dream, the ultimate goal of all of those who love Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, those who wanted to be with him. Very simple. Sponsor an orphan. Adopt an orphan. Look and take care of an orphan. Look after an orphan. Subhanallah. This is a great honor not to be missed. Their word is in proportion with the deed. It doesn't mean that the deed exactly deserves that, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most generous. It means that Allah loves this deed so much because most people will be negligent of the orphans. We visit each other because I know my friend and I go to his house and he comes to my house, he brings gifts, I go and I take gifts. But when my friend dies or whenever I die, you know, the other family forget about the other family. Very rare that they visit. Very rare that they recognize that they are in financial need. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam brought to our attention, hey, you want to be with me in paradise? Sponsor an orphan. What about the following hadith? The following hadith, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَنَا وَكَافِلُ الْيَتِيمِ لَهُ أَوْ لِغَيْرِهِ أَنَا وَهُوَ كَهَاتَيْنِ. Which means, whenever you sponsor an orphan, whether this orphan is yours, is one of your relatives, or he's somebody whom you do not know, you have no relationship to whatsoever, then you still get the same status, the same reward, that you will be with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in paradise. So, an orphan who is related to you, like, you know, your grandson. God forbid if your son dies. Like what happened with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. His son Abdullah, Abdul Muttalib's son, got married to Amina. Then he went on a trade and he died before even getting to see his son. So, Abdul Muttalib sponsored Muhammad and started looking after Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then Abdul Muttalib is his grandfather. Lahu, the orphan, is related to him. Then he died. So his uncle, Abu Talib, took charge of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was only 8 at this age. Subhanallah. He lost his father before he was born. He lost his mother at the age of 6. Then he lost his grandfather at the age of 8. So everyone who sponsored Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was related to him. The grandfather, the uncle. أولي غيره. Whenever you sponsor an orphan or orphans who are not related to you, neighbors, or Allah bless you with some wealth and you go to any non-profit organization and say, you know, I would like to sponsor a family in Gaza, or an orphan or orphans in Syria, or in Kashmir, or here or there. You know, there are many places who are in desperate need. So when you do so, you get the same status, which is you be with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, like these two fingers, the middle finger and as-sabbaha, the forefinger in paradise. What an honor. In another hadith, which is collected by Abu Dawood, may Allah have mercy on him, he narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that whenever he will be permitted to enter paradise, there will be a woman will be competing with him, racing to enter paradise at the same time. It is obviously known to us that no one should enter heaven before Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But who would dare to race? تُبَادِرُ النَّبِيَّ صَلَّى اللَّهِ وَسَلَّمَ فَإِذَا امْرَأَةٌ تُبَادِرُنِي. She is rushing to enter with me or after me at the same time. Who is he? Who is she? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, this is a woman حبست نفسها على أيتامها. She did not get married after her husband died, after she was widowed, and she devoted her life to look after her orphans. Subhanallah. Even though she's a mother, I mean, she's stuck with the kids anyway, but she devoted her life to raise her orphans. This woman would race to enter the Al-Jannah along with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and no one else. In another hadith, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, in this hadith, even though it's collected by Al-Adab Al-Mufrad, in the book of Al-Adab Al-Mufrad by Imam Al-Bukhari, the individual etiquette, but this hadith is also a weak hadith and it's collected by Ibn Majah. But the meaning is valid and is supported by many other hadith. When Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the best of houses is a house in which there is a yatim, an orphan. يُحْسَنُ إِلَيْهِ has been treated kindly. Imagine when you bring a child, an orphan who lost his father, and you bring him to live with your own kids. And your best bet is this child is under the age of weaning, still being breastfed. If your wife is capable to breastfeed the child, then in this case, don't worry about the mahramiya relationship, because if it is a girl or a boy, they will become like your own children, but simply due to suckling. أمهاتكم اللاتي أرضعنكم وأخواتكم من الرضاعة. Ayah number 23, chapter number 4. Those who are forbidden forever to marry. A woman who breastfed you whenever you were a child, 5. Satisfying times, or a woman's daughter who breastfed you. يعني if a woman breastfed a child, then this child is not allowed to marry any of her daughters because they have become brothers and sisters due to suckling. And in this case, this girl can stay at home with the man because his wife breastfed the baby, the girl. So she grew up like his own child. But there is no inheritance. There is no inheritance. The only new ruling will be that it is not permissible to marry her. And your son is not allowed to marry her. Because they are brothers and sisters due to what is known as al-radha. So the best of houses is a house in which an orphan is being treated kindly. Then he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the worst of houses is a house in which there is an orphan who has been mistreated. Then he added also in the same hadith, أنا وكافل اليتيم في الجنة هكذا، وهو يشير بإصبعيه، وهو يشير بإصبعيه. Me and the person who sponsors or takes care of an orphan will be with me like these two fingers in paradise. When some people complain that sometimes their hearts are hard and harsh, and Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave this advice, he said, امسح رأس اليتيم. What does it mean? المسح, you know, in wudu, we say, مسح الرأس. وامسحوا برؤوسكم. You wet your fingers and you wipe over your hair or head. المسح is to wipe over. امسح رأس اليتيم. You know, you don't know how much passion and how much comfort you give to an orphan when you play around with him. You put your hand over his or her head. Kids lost their fathers, lost their guardian. You support them, you buy gifts for them, you take it home. And once you tap or place your hand over their heads, this is something that softens the heart. This is as far as an advice from the Prophet ﷺ to tender your heart, to make your heart tender and soft. امسح رأس اليتيم. And also he said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, من مسح رأس يتيم لم يمسحه إلا الله. Provided you're doing this for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not because you're interested in the mother, not because, you know, for a reason or another. لا. كان له بكل شعرة مرت عليها يده حسنات. ومن أحسن إلى يتيمة أو يتيم عنده كنت أنا وهو في الجنة كهاتين وفرق بين أصبعيه السبابة والوسطى. Again, he said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if you wipe with your hand over the head of an orphan, each single hair that your hand will go over, you will have not hasana, hasanat. For each single hair, we don't count. The meaning of all of that is to tender your heart, to make you feel the need of the orphans and the families who lost their father, and to sponsor them, to support them financially. So this is an excellent investment. For those who have extra fund, who would like to do the true saving and the true investment with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to support and sponsor orphans financially, morally, by every possible mean. One of my shuyukh suggested that the best mean to sponsor an orphan fully and do full kafala is if the person marries this woman with a bunch of kids. Why? Because a woman with a bunch of kids and she's widowed, she's in need for a man to support the children, to be like a father for them, to take them out of this trauma. Even if he's not interested in this woman, he's doing this solely for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He guarantees this reward. And he himself did this a couple times for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You see what happened when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam proposed to Umm Salama, who's an old woman. He's having young wives, beautiful wives, virgin, you know, never been married before. But he proposes to Umm Salama, who lost her husband. And she says, Ya Rasulallah, but, you know, I'm an old woman and I have a bunch of kids. He said, yeah, I know, and I'm old too. And your kids will be mine. This is the sole reason why we're marrying a woman like that, or why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was ordered by Allah to marry Umm Salama or to marry a widow. You know, there are orphans who need the support of the whole society. And this is one of the legitimate reasons behind polygyny or taking or accepting or considering taking a second wife. Okay, by that, brothers and sisters, we'll have to take a short break, and inshallah in a few minutes we'll come back to you to study some more interesting hadith in this chapter. Please stay tuned.
Huda TV's social media sites are the best way to contact us from anywhere around the world. Stay connected with Huda TV's latest news and programs through Facebook, Twitter, Google+, YouTube, Skype, and Instagram. It's fast and easy. Stay up to date with your favorite shows and scholars today. Huda TV, a light in every home.
O Allah, to you belongs all praise. You are the light of the heavens and the earth and all that is within them.
إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَذَّبُوا بِآيَاتِنَا وَاسْتَكْبَرُوا عَنْهَا لَا تُفَتَّحُ لَهُمْ أَبْوَابُ السَّمَاءِ وَلَا يَدْخُلُونَ الْجَنَّةِ حَتَّى يَلِجَ الْجَمَلُ فِي سَمِّ الْخِيَاطِ.
Sister Amina is asking, is it true that you can see Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the dream? The answer is yes. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in an authentic hadith, he said, مَنْ رَآنِي فِي الْمَنَامِ فَقَدْ رَآنِي فَإِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ لَا يَتَمَثَّلُ بِي.
After the soul departs the body, it makes its journey to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If it was righteous soul, it will be given permission to enter into the heavens. But if the soul was wicked, no.
إِنَّهُ مَنْ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ الْجَنَّةِ.
Whosoever associates someone in worship with Allah, even if it is me, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make Jannah haram and lawful for that person.
رسول الله حبيب الله رسول الله حبيب الله.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته and welcome back. Our phone numbers beginning with area code are 002, then 011-25-008679. Alternatively, area code 002-01-002-46-4583. The email address is gardens@huda.tv and the Facebook page is the R. Muhammad Salah Official. In the following hadith, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gives a definition of who is al-miskin, who is the true poor person who is in need for help. Basically, the financial help. This is hadith number 264. Abu Huraira radiyallahu anhu qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, laysa al-miskinu alladhi tarudduhu at-tamratu wat-tamratan wala al-luqmatu wal-luqmatan inama al-miskinu alladhi yata'affaf. Muttafaqun alayhi. وفي رواية في الصحيحين ليس المسكين الذي يطوف على الناس ترده اللقمة واللقمتان والتمرة والتمرتان ولكن المسكين الذي لا يجد غنى يغنيه ولا يفطن به فيتصدق عليه ولا يقوم فيسأل الناس. أبو هريرة رضي الله عنه narrated that the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, said, the needy person, the poor person, is not the one who can be turned away with a date or two, a date fruit, I mean, or a bite or two. The true miskin is the one who, despite his poverty, abstains from begging. This is a hadith which is narrated by both Al-Imam Bukhari and Muslim, may Allah have mercy on them. And in another sound narration, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam again said, the needy person is not the one who goes around begging from people and who can be turned away with a morsel or two, or a date or two. The true miskin is the one who does not find enough to suffice him, does not disclose his poverty so that he might be given any charity, and does not stand up to beg. The hadith is collected by Imam Bukhari Muslim and agreed upon its authenticity as well. We perceive in general the faqir as the person who stretches out his hand and says, give me. I ask by Allah, give you, give me. I have been starving. I need to take my kids to the hospital. I need to buy food for my kids. And subhanAllah, that has become a profession now. And recently, I read in the news about a man who traveled from a very poor country to work in KSA. And it was not really working out very much for him in the beginning. So whenever he was in a financial dilemma, he went out in the street and he started begging. So people gave him. When he returned home, he realized that the outcome of begging is much better than 10 jobs. So he decided, you know what, I'm not going to work. Every day he would go and beg. And he hadn't seen his family for 15 years. He was begging until he made a fortune. He became multimillionaire. Then when he returned home, he gave to his wife a brand new SUV, very expensive car, as a gift to compensate for her suffering and his absence. And he opened a tourism company and a chain of whatever, you know. This is a person who found it palatable for him to beg. And he was not begging because he was in need. No, he was begging because it was giving him a better income than working any other job that he could do. This is exactly what the Prophet ﷺ is saying in the hadith. It's telling us sometimes you put the sadaqah in the wrong hand. There is a difference between unknowingly, and I already know that those people are faking it. They are fakers. But I just want to drop my sadaqah somewhere and that's it. Big difference, of course. So he's alerting us to pay attention to the presence of the true needy ones whom would never ask. We rather are the ones who are supposed to look for them. And that has a reference in the Quran in ayah number 273 of Surah Al-Baqarah. Allah the Almighty says, لِلْفُقَرَاءِ الَّذِينَ أُحْصِرُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ لَا يَسْتَطِيعُونَ ضَرْبًا فِي الْأَرْضِ يحسبهم الجاهل أغنياء من التعفف تعرفهم بسيماهم لا يسألون الناس إلحافا وما تنفقوا من خير فإن الله به عليم. للفقراء يعني your charity should be given to the poor. Who are they? Does everyone who stretches his hand or her hand and begging for help categorized as faqir or miskeen? La. Alladheena uhsiru fil ard. They are confined. Uhsiru fi sabilillah. They are confined in the way of Allah. They cannot go around on earth. They are either having disability or short-handed. For a reason or another, their provision is restrained for them. They cannot find a job, or if they find they cannot actually work, they are disabled. يَحْسَبُهُمُ الْجَاهِلُ أَغْنِيَاءَ مِنَ التَّعَفُّفِ. One who does not know their status may think that these guys are rich. Why? Because they never ask. Whenever people ask them, is everything okay? Yeah, cool. Everything is great. Alhamdulillah. It couldn't be better. And how's life? When others are complaining that the inflation of the prices and everything is getting expensive, those people would not even talk about it. Lest some people might recognize that they are poor and needy, and some people might give them any charity. So out of shyness, out of modesty, they would not ask. تَعْرِفُهُمْ بِسِيمَاهُمْ. You should know them by their signs. What is their prominent sign? Guess what? لا يسألون الناس إلحافا. They do not ask financial help from people inimportantly. Subhanallah. يعني Allah the Almighty is bringing to our attention in this ayah. Similarly, the hadith that we have to look for such people who are in need, because they would not ask, they would not reveal their needs, their financial need. I have some students, because of this ayah, I have witnessed that. I have some students at Al-Azhar University whom I used to teach. And they were from another country. Subhanallah, those students were extremely poor. Extremely, extremely poor. I know that they only had one outfit, a pair of trousers and a sweater, and they would be wearing this on a regular basis, every day, because hey, they don't have anything else. But they always looked neat. They always smelled great. Whenever they wanted to wash off their clothes, they would wash it. But they would stay home until it dries up so that they wear it again over and over. To that extent, how would you know that such people are poor? They are always looking neat, even though all what they have is a single outfit. And I know, on the other hand, people who stand before their closet for 15 minutes, 20 minutes, half hour, you know, being confused. Honey, what should I wear? This sweater, these trousers, or this top with these shoes, with these socks? Because we have plenty of choices. But those people, basically, they don't have this problem. They just get up, dress up the same. And what they eat every day is the same. They eat full is beans, and a common meal in Egypt. You know, rich and poor eat it, but mainly poor eat it for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. And the snacks in between, they eat full as well. So this is what they eat, and this is what they dress. But when people see them, they're looking neat. تَعْرِفُهُمْ بِسِيمَاهُمْ. What is their prominent feature? لا يسألون الناس إلحافا. So number one sign, Allah said, الجاهل, the one who does not know their reality, their, you know, financial need, would think that these guys are rich. من التعفف, because they won't ask. They're very modest. They're very shy to ask. It would kill them to say, I'm in need. Rather, they would go to sleep hungry and not ask anyone to help them to buy dinner. Their سيماهم, their sign, لا يسألون الناس إلحافا. Those are the people whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves, and those whom the people whom Allah ordered the rich people to look for them. But those whom, whenever you come to park your car here and there, they come and they say, oh, give me some, give me some, give me some, give me some, here and there. And many cases have been revealed that these people are very rich, but they have taken this as a job. Some of these people, I know, we heard about their stories. Early morning, their kids are living, their families are living in a very nice fancy villa. And they would drive their nice cars, dress up nicely in the morning, going to his company. Then he would go somewhere to change and bend his leg, tie it up, and put something over his eye and pretend that he's handicapped, and sit in the street to beg. And that was their job. They have become addicted to that. Okay. It is true that whenever you see a beggar, you should not repel him. وَمَسَّائِلَ فَلَا تَنْهَرْ. No, insult him. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, قَوْلٌ مَعْرُوفٌ وَمَغْفِرَةٌ خَيْرٌ مِّن صَدَقَةٍ يَتْبَعُهَا أَذَى. So the alternative is, if I know that there are people who are more worthy, I should pay my charity to such people. And I should not encourage those who are taking this as a job. One day, while my kids were in the car, and I was fixing the wheels, a child came to sell me some incense. So I said, how much? He said, much. I said, okay. And I started talking to him. I pulled off my car, and I sat on the platform with him. And I said, what is your name? And where are you living? And why are you doing this? He said that my father died, and I'm in school, and I'm working only on Fridays so I can buy a pair of shoes for my brothers who are going to school. This is heartbreaking, right? He does not ask for help. He is selling some incense, maybe making some, you know, little bit of profit, but he's only working on Friday. Okay, I went furthermore to investigate. And which school are you in? He said, such and such school in the sixth grade. Okay, I have some of my kids in sixth grade whom I teach and I know exactly what they study. I said, what do you have in the Arabic syllabus? He told me. So I tested him. And how much surah do you know of the Quran? That much, that's it. تعرفهم بسيماهم. You recognize this person who is a representative of a family. He is working to provide for a family while he is only in the sixth grade. He's about 11 to 12 years old at maximum. Subhanallah. In this case, it will be a shame. If you bargain with him and he says £5, you say no, 3.5. Or I will take 2 for 5. This is nonsense. Such person, you need to guard his iffah, his modesty, and say, I would buy it, or I would buy all of what you have, and here is $100, go and study. Let me drop you home. And on the way, you buy him a pair of shoes, and you buy how many brothers and sisters you have. You buy them all brand new shoes, like your own kids. This is the best investment. Especially that you knew that he's an orphan. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is bringing to our attention that there are people who are definitely in need, but we are being negligent of their need because we're giving our money somewhere else, taking it easy when somebody says, give me. And this is very common in Hajj and Umrah. People come to our tents in Mina, and while we're sitting, you know, making our adhkar between the adhan and iqama, you find a man or a woman walking around say, I lost my passport and I lost my wallet and I can't go home. Yahi, if you want to lie, at least you have to understand that there are some sane people around who would not swallow your lie. Because as we all know that when you go to perform Hajj, number one, at the entry they collect your passport. So how do you claim that you lost your passport and you lost your ticket? You used to use the same lie 10 years ago when the ticket was like a carton, a very hard copy. But now you don't need to carry a ticket with you. So it's very obvious this person is a liar. Then I'm not going to give you anything. While eating somewhere, I was actually walking and I saw people at a fast food restaurant in Mecca. And I saw this man was gazing from the window at those who are eating. And his mouth was wet. He was hungry and was starving. That's it. You don't need to go and ask him whether you're hungry or not. Can I help you by any need? You already know that he's in need. So those people, لا يسألون الناس إلحافا. لا يسألون الناس إلحافا. I was invited by a very rich person once. And we have lunch. Then after we finished, it is my habit to take to go, the leftover. I would eat it. My family would eat it. Any person would eat it. And he said, you know, you made me happy, Sheikh. I said, well, I said, because I always do that. I take the leftover to go. Why? He said, you know, when you step out, you normally find poor people who would really appreciate the sandwich, which was going to end up in the trash. Subhanallah, we just stepped out. And a man was walking around, and once we gave him the sandwich or the sandwiches, he was extremely happy and praising Allah and thanking us so much. So the hadith is inviting us to be practical and offer the practical help, not just the superficial one, give those and whom you know that they are not actually in need. In the hadith, Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, من يسأل الناس تكثرا من يسأل الناس تكثرا فإنما يسأل جمرا فليستقل من ذلك أو ليستكثر. Wow. Those who ask beg from people تكثرا, يعني تكثرا, they are not in need, but since it works, since when I sit with this person he says, you know, I start softening his heart and I say that my son is in the hospital, my mother-in-law is suffering and I cannot find food. So he gives me and that gives me and that person gives me. So he's asking and begging takathuran to increase his wealth. He's not actually in need. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying that فَإِنَّمَا يَسْأَلُ جَمْرًا. He's only taken burning coal, piece of fire. فَلْيَسْتَقِلَّ مِنْ ذَلِكَ أَوْ لِيَسْتَكْثِرُ. Then let him take little or much. As much as you take, you're only taking fire. You're only taking fire. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ordering us to put our trust in Him alone. In Surah At-Talaq, in ayah number 3, said, وَمَنْ يَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ فَهُوَ حَسْبُهُ إِنَّ اللَّهَ بَالِغُ أَمْرِهِ. Whosoever puts his trust in Allah alone, and truly, Allah is sufficient for him. Today, I'm rich. Allah knows tomorrow what is going to happen. If I lose my job, if I lose my investment, I may be in need. Put your trust only in Allah. Because Allah would let you become a liability or dependent on the one whom you put your trust in. Yani, some people think, Alhamdulillah, my friend is such and such and he's a rich person. Ya salam. So you only trust your friend because he's rich, and if you are in need, he will help you. And Allah does not appear on your screen, on your radar. That doesn't make any sense. Dismiss all of that and put your trust only in Allah. Do not ask unless if you are desperately in need. We ran out of time, but in fact, we have a lot more to talk about this particular subject from a practical point of view. So hopefully, inshallah, we'll continue with it in the beginning of the next episode next week, inshallah. Until then, brothers and sisters, I leave you all in the care of Allah. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم. وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
رسول الله حبيب الله. Allah, our God, is the greatest, the one and only glory to Him. He born in humans to be the best and give His best religion to them. Allah, our God, is the greatest, the one and only glory to Him. He born in humans to be the best and give His best religion to them.
So why did they ignore that? Forgetting all about it in paradise, worshipping cows, fire and stones, selling the best with the cheapest price.
So why did they ignore that? Forgetting all about hell and paradise, worshipping cows, fire and stones, selling the best with the cheapest price.
Rasulullah.